democratic. Our state has not been democratic. There's no governance. What do you mean by democracy? Let's be very briefly. Democracy or democratic state is one in which there is a separation of powers. An accountable executive, a vibrant legislature, and a fiercely independent judiciary. That's what defines democracy. When a coup takes place, such as it happened in our case, and we can discuss the implications thereof, it means the military, which is under the executive, is now above the executive. The king is not Nangawa, the king now is Chiwenga, if you want to be factual about matters. And so we have a situation where military rule is a reality. What does this mean for us? I think it offers both challenges and opportunities. What are the challenges? The challenges are that, one, the developments that just happened take place against the background of an incomplete constitution-making exercise. Significantly, the constitution of 2013 had not been fully implemented. Secondly, it was clear that the state had neither the capacity to effect political change, such as effecting the constitution, nor effect economic change, as we saw in the case of the Lima process. So what does it mean politically for the way ahead? If we have an incomplete constitution-making exercise, if you have a mutual rule, and the declaration that there will be elections 7 months hence, what kind of elections are likely to have? I spoke the other day at the ZESEN meeting. I said, you are going to have a command elections. What does that mean? The comrades will act the way they did. Have a very strong commissariat. This was a term used during the war. And Chiwenga was a political commissar. They'll be deploying the political commissars across the country very soon. They will be in charge of the registration of voters. They'll be in charge of the election. The outcome, as they say, is predictable. I should also say, what we're going through was largely predictable. Mungai knows the number of debates we've had at Sabis about possible changes. I remember, lest you think that this project, the military project, is a Lacoste project alone, or that the G40 were bystanders. In the previous life, and I'm talking about 3-4 years ago, 2012, I remember having a debate with one of the S12 G40 members. I won't name him or her. And I said, what will happen if Mugabe dies? It's 2012. And he offered a glass of whiskey, said, my dear friend, don't think your sister, Joyce Mujuru, will take over as vice president. We'll deploy our forces, take all the key areas, ZBC, the support units, almost the book, what happened a few days ago. What was the common factor then? At that time, the G40 member concerned was very close to the military, to Chiwenga. They worked together, they lived next to each other, and what a day. Things changed, 2015. Enter, and military effects, what that which would have happened and Mugabe died before the events. What date was it, the coup? 17th, 18th? So some of us have been expecting this, except that we expected that this would happen almost certainly because Mugabe had failed in the succession planning and allowed his wife to become as imperious as he was in a very incredible fashion. So that is what. So that's the challenge. The challenges politically are those to do with the kind of political change and the possibilities of returning to democratic and constitutional rule. This is the challenge. And we have to think about it very carefully. While we celebrate the beginning of change, there's no doubt that the departure of Mugabe signifies an important change in our country. No doubt about that. Except that on the other hand, it tells us very poignantly that Mugabe was only a cog in a system which he thought he controlled. I was one of those who had been writing since last year saying that Mugabe was in control of the secretary of state. I realize now that Mugabe has never been in control of the military. In Mozambique, for example, those of us who were there or be briefly would remember that the most powerful person was Tomoka. And when he came home in 1980, the most powerful person was Rex Njuru until his death. And now the most powerful person in this country is Chiwenga. We have no illusion about that. So, history is teaching us some lessons of the relationship between a guerrilla army and the post-independence period. The opportunities, I'm sure Mungai is more versed than I am to speak about opportunities. The opportunities lie, one, in the reaction to the coup, both regionally and internationally. Internationally, it is clear that this has been cooking for a long time. And so Katrina Lange would hardly hold herself with glee, shaking the hand of Emerson Mnangagwa. Deja vu, like, you know, so excited. And then significantly, not one of those powers, Britain, US, China, has called this a coup. The word coup doesn't exist anymore in the vocabulary. And of course, the link between the international and the region. I mean, you saw Zuma shaking hands with Emerson Mnangagwa before he was inaugurated. What was Emerson Mnangagwa then? At that stage, on the Wednesday, before the Saturday inauguration. Now, I'm not trying to be cynical, I'm just saying that to the extent that the various international factors, who are very important in the history and development of this country, see a breakthrough in the departure from Mugabe, must be significant not only to them but also to ourselves. You heard yesterday Boris Johnson announced that conditional on a what did he call it, democracy? Something, democratic change. Our loan, World Bank loan and ADB loan will be paid off. And so on and so forth. Yesterday I was in the airport meeting my son and the Chinese delegation, a very august Chinese, arrived. My friend, the deputy ambassador of China, had no time to greet me. He says, no, I can't greet you now. And you saw what happened yesterday, big meeting. So everybody's excited. Less known to you is that the US sent a congressman over the last weekend. Less visible than the British one. It was almost thought it was 18th of April, 1980. The way he strolled into Harare, very imperious, representing the Queen and more. Anyway, so suddenly the chance of the so-called sanctions going very high. suddenly re-engagement high. Debt forgiveness, is it? Almost likely. Everything is there. Great opportunities. Secondly, I would say that the possibilities of us following the Rwanda or Ethiopian model or the Myanmar model is very high. Needless to add, Emerson Mnangagwa and the military will want to show to the ordinary person on the street that there is possibility of change. For the person on the street, the majority of our people, the constitutional arguments and legalities that don't matter. Whether it's a coup or not, sad point. They want to see an immediate change in their lives. The expectation that our people headed to independence is that which gives them now, and much more than 1980. And clearly, we have to see to what extent the economic program in the next few months unfolds. My hope, however, is that in the spirit of what we call the developmental democratic state, that the democracy dividend is not forgotten. As forgotten as it is in Ethiopia, as forgotten as it is in Rwanda. That we'll be able, as professionals that we are here, to insist, which we must, to the return of constitutional and democratic governance, to the era of separation of powers, an accountable executive, a vibrant legislature, and a fiercely independent judiciary. That's my hope. Thank you.
For these and other stories, visit our website www.263chat.com. Follow us on Twitter @263chat and like our Facebook page, 263chat.